it's available to you. Without further ado, Paul, I think I just took 5 of your minutes. This man tweets as Hormetic, H-O-R-M-E-T-I-C.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah. Welcome. Thank you. How fun. Okay, so tonight I took the title from a work of art, and what I want to think about is how to feel better, and we can talk about that for the rest of the night. So I'll just kind of talk about what are emotions for? Why do we have them, and what do they do? Very briefly, I'm going to connect that to how emotions still elude the search for intelligence. So you definitely have all this natural language processing, but you don't have emotional intelligence, except these little presentiments. And then I'll talk about a bunch of qualities that I think help make bots personable. So it's going to be important to start with our feelings. And if you really try to tickle yourself, what you'll realize is the first thing that an emotion has, and we're all experts here, is that it's compelling to your attention. It is, resistant to an emotional override. You're like, well, I don't want to feel that way right now. And the feeling is stronger than your will. It holds your attention. Then there's a whole bunch that we'll unpack further about the symbolic, the cognitive, the interpretive act of like changing something from having your toes stepped on to having somebody do it on purpose to hurt you. Then there's obviously the iceberg that could be talked about endlessly, but I won't. There is the motor expression, which we all work from, and which maybe some of you are already familiar with. I'll talk a little bit about the fact that our face is so well-tuned to a certain set of emotional predictors that you can actually watch the face and extract a lot of signal. Then, of course, whatever feelings you have change as you interocept yourself. So you're watching and you feel like proprioception tells you where your body is. Interoception is that part about like suddenly noticing things about the way your stomach feels. And there you go, and there's the way your stomach feels. There is definitely an emotional component to our guts. And then different people might have different types. Somebody might be highly anxious. And of course, your memories are going to feed into that. And then finally, we don't usually talk about that because almost all the psychology that gets published and that I pay attention to is weird. And that's just a recognized acronym that, number one, I mean, they're all obviously Stanford undergrads from my point of view, but they're westernized, they're educated, they're from an industrialized country, they're rich, and the entire background is democratic. Basically, they're Americans and Western Europeans. And of course, that means that like when we're talking about emotion, we're talking about that tiny little clipped component that can exist in a place like Palo Alto. Not the extremes, just like the intensity of that little vibration. Because in other cultures, it might be quite different. Now, one of the things that makes this both interesting and hard is that you can see each of these as a source of what you feel. Number one is just your thoughts. Oh my God, I saw my partner kissing my neighbor. And then you just think, that feels different. So you suddenly think something. And then you have all these emotions. And then you make certain kinds of behaviors. And every single one of those affects the next chain of your thoughts, or your emotions, or your behavior. So let's just admit, it's a really complicated circuit. And there are plenty of ways to kind of simplify it. I was mentioning the very fact that the face muscles are sufficiently tuned to just be a mirror to your feelings that these typologies have held up across a lot of time. Maybe not across all cultures, that's an exaggeration, but certainly they work well enough that by the late 90s, MIT's Media Lab had a SDK, a software development kit that would use eye tracking and 1999 LiDAR to move around and respond to your face. And that was enough to couple your emotion to drive something on the computer. And now it's an open source kit where you can just use the video to just passively record and attend to these kinds of coarse emotions. So that's certainly going to mean that our technology can become so much more intimate with us. I'm not going to talk about this other model, except to say that if you really crave two-by-twos, there is one, which is, you'll understand the x-axis, which is pleasant to unpleasant. You know, that level of intensity is directly experienced every day. And most things, believe it or not, seem to be below zero. But then the intensity is the other way of, you know, looking at that. So you can have, you know, both intense positive and intense negative emotions. And that is a kind of nice way to just admit that we don't really know what we're talking about, but we need to talk about something. Because what you immediately find out when you try and measure this is that you can't rely on the face to really get below, because what you're measuring may be, you know, some level of excitement and maybe some measure of intensity, but the cognitive appraisal, the attribution, can be so significantly different that it turns a plus to a minus. And the reason I have a car here is that as we go through these, imagine that you are the driver and you suddenly find yourself responding with, who is to blame? Do you know that feeling where you're like, you're in a conflict and you immediately feel more when you can feel who's to blame? And then you are very sensitive to control. People want to twist each other into like just mind games. You just imply that they don't have control. And people freak out in order to preserve a little face. And alongside all of these others, you begin to understand that these are just as real as the face emotions. These are just as structured, so that if you learn how to respond to the attention, you can actually work in congruence with the person and their physiological signal, which is cool. And that's why I put a car there. Okay? One thing I wanted to just talk about repeatedly is how simple things are and still psychological. So this is a paper from the 1940s where this guy made these objects interact. Now, I don't have time to play the sound, but there's a whole story connected to that. And that story is that no matter how you show these to people, the ways they're going to explain it are going to be something like this. Oh, this one's mad at that one and hit him. And then the little guy is being chased by the big guy, and then the big guy gets intimidated by the little guy, and now they bump into each other, and now they're chasing, and now they're running away. Which is just to say, these were, when Michaud did them in the 40s, they were clearly just light sources. And yet you can't not feel just an intuition of agency, which is great in a certain way. And it helps once you start to realize that, you know, we're making these attributions, and these attributions have a real structure. So you can actually come to get somebody to reveal what they want to feel like by asking the right questions and stacking it over time, so that you have opportunities to recognize that most emotions are in response to movement. I want to move, I want to get, I want to have a goal and move somewhere. Because as soon as something's not goal relevant, it's not going to evoke an emotion. And once it does seem relevant to your goal, you immediately and directly can tell whether it's advancing your goal, yes, I'm winning, or, you know, blocking you, they are attacking me. And then you can see that there are various ways that, like, if some people have a hard time believing that there are any emotions that aren't ego involved, but happiness is something where you could feel it in public and not be the only person feeling it, or not even caring that, you know, the other people are feeling. Nevertheless, I only show these things to remind us of how complicated it's going to be. But here's the nice thing. There's also this simplicity. This is a Twitter feed that just finds faces and things. And if you see these, then you can't not see them because they're there. And certainly anyone who's in this chatbot space recognizes, and I would be saying what you already know, that the very first chatbot was like the Don Quixote of novels, which was also its first. It had so much in it that it seems like Eliza is better than things that exist now. And it was the first thing, and it was 1966, and it was in like 8K of memory. And it was just a script that simulated a Rogerian psychotherapist. And how does that make you feel? Tell me more about. And as anyone who's taken the chance to interact with Eliza, even after you know that she's fake, it's fake. You still find yourself emotionally entwined with the very proto. And then certainly you can't not mention this dude when you're talking chatbots. It's, you know, it's only not profane because his death is on the picture. You know, if it just said, see 1977, you know, 1997, they'd be like, but what happened to him? What happened to him? And Microsoft did kill him. But why was he the worst? Because unlike Eliza, Clippy wanted you to think about Clippy. So that's going to be a point that is easy to point out whenever people cross that line. Now, I just want to exhort people to realize that we don't have to be hi-fi. And for me, one of the best ways of recognizing how low the bar is to aspirationally compare yourself not to a person, but to a cat. And that really helps articulate. Some people have Shetland ponies as service animals. I don't know what their specialty is, but compare yourself to a Shetland pony. The point that I'm trying to advance is that we don't need to make people to make emotionally rich, interesting relationships. Because, you know, even in service dogs, there's this attunement, which is super interesting and not as far out of reach as, say, full cognitive awareness of what the emotions are. So this is just something I tend to like keep a running list of, which is just how many ways can you measure? So, you know, this could be, you know, some kind of matrix, or even, you know, these could be 8 sheets of, you know, data in a spreadsheet, and then it could all kind of correlate, because you can clearly matrix this. The number one is just, you know, how are you feeling? That's 90% of psychology right there. The second is a little more mediated, where you ask people not, you know, is this person hot or not, but you say, how many people will say this picture of a boy is hot or not? So to be clear, what you're doing in the second is having people predict what the average person would feel. And that's plenty of information for knowing how to connect, you know, the emotion. You just say, you know what, I know that this is like, well, it would be absurd. I know this is like a 7 out of 9 in humor. You know, you can describe it almost like it was quantitatively fixed. And for purposes of our study, since we're talking on to chatbots and aside, we are going to have to make it arbitrarily bucketed. But you can have people who are never going to have that feeling help you understand what that feeling is by asking them, how would you feel if you saw this message? How would you feel if this happened to you? How would you feel if you were going through this interaction? And they're not going through it, but you're still paying for their simulated empathy. And it's great information. I won't be talking about, but it's clearly obvious that this is probably going to beat the humans in row two, which is that big machine learning corpora can train up, and then you can just, you know, munge a whole bunch of newsfeed or emails and come up with measures, or even a running average of the emotional intensity. And you know, it's one of the things that we'll play with. I don't think anyone's going to be able to say that it's changed their life yet. Pupil dilation is one of the simplest and oldest measures of attention. But Danny Kahneman, who was at Princeton at the time, could stand outside the room and look at a projection of somebody's pupil in a little kind of like film projector. So it was like maybe closed circuit TV. It's the mid-60s. But he would be able to give him problems and then shout into the room even though they were behind him, "So you gave up now. Do you want to go to the next thing?" And they would always say, "How did you know I gave up?" And it's that threshold obvious that even a psych professor can recognize it. So you can actually track the dilation of the pupil as, you know, cognitively equivalent to the pulse. And you can at least get a really coarse but accessible way of what emotional temperature somebody's running just by paying attention to their pupil. And the facial coding I mentioned, so they're all those zygomatic muscles. Voice, certainly anyone in customer service probably promises to find gold in all that pigeon manure. So, and then you can do heart rate, which is a very coarse measure and which everyone hoped would be able to help husbands and wives talk. But it's not sensitive enough to say to Ma and Pa, just wear these, and whenever your heart rate goes above 99, just friendly, you say, "Hey, when I get to 120, I'm actually unpleasant." You know, you'll always know when you're on the corner of having something bad happen to you because you'll be wearing your heart monitor. I'm here to tell you that, according to evidence, it does not tell you fast enough. It does not have enough sensitivity to save you anything. It is a flashlight in a mud storm. So, and finally, skin conductance is actually what lie detectors do, and so it's a very noisy signal. But now I'm going to talk about something that someone I know said, "You know, you're training bots to do all the things you can't do at all well." I was like, "Well, it is the case that many of my teachers taught the one thing that they needed to know themselves. For me, it's observing how helpful it would be to be treated politely. And it's possible to kind of turn it into a handbook that you would read at Hamburger University, how to handle a bad situation. And it would be a cookbook, but it would be as clear and scripted as making the fries. It would just say, "When you get to this level, say these words." And I have actually had people say words to me from a credit card company that were magical. The woman on the other side said, "You know, I would feel the same as you do if I were in your situation." And that was like transformative in terms of the rest of our interaction. So for all I know, she says that to everybody, but she said it to me. And I would like to point out that there's a pretty developed set of tips semi-formalized in things like politeness manuals, just because of deference and making requests indirect. The whole reason you do that, in every setting where you're saying, instead of, you know, submit to print, you say, "Would you like to?" You create this indirection in part because you create all these situations where people are going to have to feel like they're ignorant or wrong or out of control or in any sense that they aren't comfortable with. You're creating a collision with their concept of themselves as something rosy. And that's impolite. And here I use Lark as an example where, you know, as soon as something goes wrong, the Lark takes the credit for making things bad. So a long time ago, Alan Cooper wrote up his list of 14 principles of polite apps. The one thing I would say is that if you look at this, this is actually not simply being polite. Because for me, politeness is just not creating negative discomfort, you know, not threatening the face in an overt way. It is not making me comfortable. It does not require knowing me so well that, you know, it feels like a back rub. It's not all of these things, but it would be great if they existed. If it were interested in me, and it can be at the limit of what we are able to now, at least pay attention to what you say. That feels great. Being deferential is something that is pretty much capable of just being captured in scripted language. Forthcoming is basically, you know, when the prophet arrives. There's not really, I mean, there's some anticipatory things. Alan wrote this 5 years before autocomplete, when he said, you know what, it should just kind of guess where I'm going. And you know, even today, it's nice when you encounter autocomplete. So if only we could do it on a higher scale, and that's what his polite apps would do. Long story short, as much as I like this, I would, you know, distinguish my sense of politeness from Alan Cooper's by just saying, you know, it was his dream, and I'm trying to be a little more specific. So the next thing I think that bots have to do is just be intuitive, and a lot of that in behavioral economics wraps up to just having smart defaults. And a smart default can be measured by assuming that attention is moving towards zero, okay? It's simply assuming that people will not pay attention to anything you're trying to say. So then you ask, well, what will happen when I fail to get their attention, and I fail to get their opt-in, and I fail to even get a moment of interaction with the human on the other side of the glass, and just have them see the menu? They won't read it, so they can't pick. Well, if you know they're not going to give you very much attention, you give all your attention to what will happen in the zero state. And there was a bot, Amy, who many people really were fond of because she had a very clear circumscribed role, which was like you'd CC her on a conversation with somebody and say, yeah, let Amy set up a meeting for us. And because she had access to your calendar, she would be able to work with the other person. And all that stuff about setting up a meeting was pushed off onto another person. And if you look here, they understand that like what you really want to do is stop thinking about this. You want to sign off and just say, yeah, you handle it. And yet, what we don't think about often is that the way we handle it is the way almost everyone's going to feel it. And you can't excuse the way we handle it by saying, oh, if they didn't like it, they could have made it different. The whole point is that what we create is what people experience. For me, I think this next concept of empowerment is probably as close to monetizing my kids as I can get, because almost all of this has been honed negotiating with, you know, like baboon-sized intellects with a lot of muscle. So it's clear to me, and I have demonstrated this in like tax filing products as well, so it's affected millions of people, is that you can say, you know what? I know they tell you you have to go through door A and door B, but look at me. I'm willing to let you choose. Which one do you want to go through first? And suddenly, the choice transforms the experience. And it is possible to create choices in one version of how I conceive of our field. I think that we're menu designers. We're like the architects, the chefs who make the meal. But we don't get to choose what people pick on the menu. There's a lot you can do. I thought I had, yeah, there we go. So here's an example of the way Lark handles this. And I really think that it's empowering to see that, you know, it has both a nice, gentle default, and it's allowing you to make a kind of nudge back. Oops, sorry about that. Good. The next thing, and I think this is hard to admit, is that people don't mind being flattered. It's really pleasant. And it costs nothing for a chatbot to flatter, because it has to say something. And it could say something nice. Let me show you an experiment I ran in my neighborhood. You see these two signs. It says, you bring joy to those around you. The other, on the other side of the tree, says, your smile is beautiful. And you could just take one. And it even recommended that you consider giving it to somebody whose smile is beautiful. But I put that up, and within 48 hours, there was a real demand for the supply of compliments from my printer, which is a very nice printer. And I'm talking about its kindness. It's willing to say nice things. So maybe you're thinking that, you know, we're complex animals. Can we really be nudged around by fortune cookies? Isn't that what we're saying? If I give you a slogan, if I give you a prompt or a reminder or a choice, or I chat with you, basically I'm saying something that at best passes a low bar Turing test. But it can actually make me feel much better if they choose their words right. And if you want to know, like for me, there's a very popular book that's very practical called Feeling Good, which is basically ways to look at your thoughts and just change like the verb tense, change it so that it has a qualifier, you know, instead of saying everything's terrible, you just say this, I don't like, and you know, I don't know about the rest. And that became cognitive behavioral therapy. And you know, as of late, it's like C++ BT is called DBT. And the only difference is that the cognitive approach is really like stoicism. It says, look, you get to think about how you want to think about this. I had an interview with the founder, and I was telling him that I felt really frustrated that I had gotten a PhD and that I was working in the Valley, and that the people around me were basically the kind of people who brag about stealing the test. You know, like people who think that that was their measure of accomplishment was to cheat well. So they were all stockbroker types. And I was kind of frustrated with the limited access I had to actually making an impact. And I went and talked to Albert, and he said, look, you want respect. And I was like, yeah, don't I deserve it? And he goes, no, people don't have to respect you, you know? You can like it, but how much control do you really have over whether other people respect you? And as soon as you realize that, then you change, and this is a verb tense thing. Instead of it's horrible that I don't have it, is you just say the same thing in a different tone when you say, I really would like to have that. That's it. And then you have all the value without what he sloganized as things that were really catchy, like you should all over yourself, and that means I should be liked, I should be able to do that. He goes, stop shoulding all over yourself. And his other was masturbation, just like, must you have a car that is impressive to kids who only like Teslas? And nevertheless, as soon as I thought about this, I thought, you know, it's not just fortune cookies that we use to tickle ourselves. We use songs, we use stories, we use plays. It's effective if you have the right slogan in your view. Now, I won't say more about that right now because I want to finish this set of things that I think are relevant. One is to say, I'm on your side. We're partners. So if you recall Clippy, before he died, because it was Microsoft, they paid Stanford, Cliff Nass lab, a lot of money to find out how they could improve Clippy. And the only thing they found that helped was that, like, they knew that Clippy was obnoxious and hated. But when it annoyed people, which was always, Clippy would say, listen, I'm so sorry. I'm going to go back and tell those damn programmers at Microsoft that they have to make me better. Would you like me to relay your complaint? And people liked Clippy a lot more. I don't know if it was actually passable, but the point was, even Clippy could have emphasized some team-like affiliation. And when you have that, you know, it's a high five. MailChimp is famous for this. And here's another Lark way of saying, you know, we're in this together. And, you know, we're a partnership. Any way that you can evoke that is great. Now, this next point is simply to say that, I don't know how far to take this, but it's certainly statistically revealing that sometimes, if you don't know anything more about somebody, just matching them can help. So you can mirror their body language. I don't know how reliable that is, but it's certainly the case that tone, frequency, speed, things like that are helpful if you mirror them. And because chatbots have this conversation that's a little more predictable, they can actually talk about their little space in a way that's, you know, maybe relevant. Now, for me, and maybe this is my bias, is forever dealing with people who think that they have some great idea and they have to find some way to make people listen to them talk about how great their idea is. And that is basically the same as saying that we're dead, because nobody has time to listen to how great you are. And it's just a fact that being great is not enough to deserve my attention. And so for all the utility that you promise, if people will just read the QuickBooks manual, you know in advance that no one is going to do it. But there is a way to get people to acquire information. And that is to pose it as challenges, to pose it as a question. Because even that level of uncertainty has worked for BuzzFeed. So again, I'm leaning heavy on Lark, but I think they have a really nice language. They really do. And I like the way they explore letting you find out, progressively discover things. Now, humor is great. I wish psychologists, if we all got together in like a Los Alamos project, and we used everything I know in behavioral economics, everything cognitive psychologists know, and the personality psychologists, so they say extroverted, introverted, we all get together and we design a study, and this is still true, that brain trust could not design a funny story, could not make a joke. The fact that all that we know about psychology can't even help you be a little bit funnier shows how weak psychology is. Because if you can't even tickle somebody, then you clearly don't know enough about them to do any major control. And so I used to tell people to relax, because although I was at Stanford and although I was an experimental psychologist, my entire life had been finding out how weak experiments were. So it's true that humor is great, but I can't tell you anything about that except to respect, admire, revere the progeny of Stuart Butterfield. Because Flickr used to be the tone that showed what it was like to be human, to kind of know what the other person was trying to get from you. And with Slack, you actually see this progression towards something that's darn close to what we feel comfortable with. And I'm not gonna detail too much on like the actionability, except to say that because I focus on behavior, what I'm really interested in is ways that changing language changes behavior. And as soon as you pay attention to that, you find out that most language doesn't make that much difference, or the difference is pretty small. Usually you move from like 50-50 to 55-45. That would be a win. Let me just say that. I have to say that's not like something I have every 5 years. It's something that makes things 10% better, just nakedly, boom, before we even start optimizing. But it is to say that it should always be focused on the behavior. And people appreciate that. Then finally, there's the trust aspect, which I think is pretty hard to separate from the previous nine. It really is. If you don't deliver on any of those, if you're not polite to me, that's it. Like, you know, like at each stage, if you blow it, one of the nice things about trust is that it's so easy to break. That's what makes it the thing you pay attention to, because it's like the little wrapper around the mouth of a, you know, Tylenol bottle, because it's very easy to tear that. But until it's teared, it is something you can trust. And so what you want is something that is eggshell thin, public, and massively unforgiving of tampering. So that's what trust is. And when I tell you that, then you just realize, oh, well, how do I earn the trust? Basically, you give people something they want. And I could say more about ways that you can get people to appreciate what they want. That particular approach is associated a lot with Kayak, because they were the pioneers of just telling you while they were doing their song and dance. And that kind of behavior where you're like, gee, boss, I'm trying to get this done, but I can't get it now, so I want to just entertain you in a nice, simple way, is a nice thing to do. And one of the surprising things about labor transparency is that you can actually make things longer and better because you give them a little mint on their pillow. Okay. And so Penny is another little bot that has a lot of nice behavioral love in their dialogue. So what are personable bots? For me, this first thing is like probably the most constraining. These are all the negative things. These are the things that if you get them wrong, it's over. So you kind of just have to deliver these. And the polite, well, basically no. The airlines have proven that you do not have to be polite so long as you have like a, quasi-monopoly. But still, politeness is like a make or break thing. And intuitive is really what we all try and do, which is just emulate intuit and be, I'm kidding when I say that, but I always like that a whole group of people care about our intuitions. As soon as you ask that, you get a better answer than trying to like change people's intuitions. So being intuitive is a massive win. And so is empowering. That was a little harder, but as I'm trying to explore myself, I think you can just say that people are empowered and get some lift. So the next part is like the flattery, which I really feel is underexplored. Just making people feel nice. The being on my team is a little more cognitively complex, but it's there. And reflecting back depends on how well you read the signal. But to the extent that there is a signal there and you want to pay attention to it, that suddenly gives you the steps all the way down to deciding how to mirror it back. And then for me, curiosity is hugey, but I didn't maybe make that case compelling tonight. Humorous is just a blast. There is, for some domains, a level of humor that starts to have more damage than help. There is such a thing as being too funny as an impact on the discourse. Still, like we're a million miles from there. Actionable is really, make sure this is cashing out in behavior. And because you're paying attention to that, that it is cashing out in behavior, you're gonna earn the trust. So that's that thing, which I just call pie for chat. So, it just makes it sweet. And you have this list, which was perfectly happy to stop at 10. And, could be changed and, we could probably change all the terms and keep the acronym, but I'm not talking about anything except a list of things that I found helpful. And to kind of close this, I wanted to connect people to another arbitrary scheme. We all understand that we're telling stories. We all realize that until you find a way of talking about your thinking, I guess you're not a designer. Because a designer tries to communicate a very complex thing. And they're saying, what do you think of this? And that's almost always best looked at as a story. Jared Spools made a clear argument for that. I'm persuaded. IDEO makes a business, basically, out of being just amazing storytellers. There's lots of methods to inspire their stories. But they're totally happy if it's just a great story. Why not? It's an activity that feels good. But the reason I mention this 12 archetypes is simply to say, like, as soon as you start thinking about having relationships between the bot and the person, you have to ask, well, what's the role? Are they a coach? Are they a mommy? Are they a daddy? Are they a teacher? Are they a sensei? Are they a waiter? Are they a butler? As soon as you start to think that through, you might find this kind of scheme helpful. again, not exhaustive, but simply better than just pulling these out of your own air. Which is to say, you know, you can go through and you can go, okay, like a lot of people have mapped this. This is a story that I encourage us to pay attention to, not for its literal value, but for the fact that, like, we could really think about a whole bunch of genres for people to interact with software. You could actually, and probably within a finite amount of time, you know, choose like a Hong Kong kung fu mode of engaging with word processing and web browsing. Because it's simply you moving around and the computer playing with you. And as soon as you say that, then you think, okay, well, I would like to just spend my time in a video game shooting people. Can you give me choices there? And they're like, yeah, would you like the ghetto? Would you like the World War II? Would you like, you know, the racist dream? Would you like, you know, like you can get your fantasy fulfilled. And the only mapping I'm making here is to point out that role-playing can be done in very pedestrian settings. Very boring activities can still be a little better if you put the lipstick on the pig. This is my, or the perfume, whatever it is, all of this works even if it's just frosting. I'm trying to remind people that they should not be so frosting disdainful or lipstick, you know, sexist. There's nothing wrong with makeup. There's every fine restaurant knows how much of your eating is your eyes. And we have access to people's eyes. We have access to their dreams. We have access to their money. We have access to all the parts of their life that are emotionally rich. And we're not really taking advantage of the ways that we could talk to, you know, a bot, a device that for all its limitations still makes us feel better. So that's it.
Okay. No, don't have a question yet. You're cooking on the question.
Yes. Excellent.
So, are you talking very specifically only about chatbots?
Not really. I should have been a little clearer. Yeah. I talked to somebody about the fact that, like, really, at this stage of development,
yeah,
we're just drawing, you know, spoke button bubbles over command lines.
Yeah,
yes.
It strikes me that there's a sort of a continuum of agentness that any kind of,
yes,
like digital system you're interacting with is, and so you can imbue it with these roles and these things. And so, can you put humor into Photoshop now?
I think so. Sure. I mean, the thing is, as I said, you know, I could probably predict that no one will do it tonight. But the thing is, can you make Slack funny? I mean, it wasn't born cute; it was made to be cute. And it works. I'm saying something kind of obvious when I say, be like Slack. You know, it was like, you know, it's also still useful. If you can't quite be Slack, just settle for being Apple. I'm sorry that it's not more directive than simply to say, like, you could learn a lot from studying how they talk.
So thinking about emotional, you know, empathetic responses. My company has a virtual nurse avatar, and one of the things we're struggling with is when and how to give that empathetic response. Because we'll find, for example, if somebody's telling us something negative, and we say, you know, I'm really sorry to hear that, some people will say, that's so fake, that's so lame, your avatar is telling me it's sorry, it's not sorry. But other people are like, yeah, you know, thank you, like the Eliza, you know, when it feels like they're being. So we're trying to figure out, and I don't know if you have any advice, how do we know how far to go and when to go there, in these,
right,
especially on the negative side? When,
right,
it's someone's being a positive thing, they're more likely to be like, you know, good job. People are like, yay. But if it's negative, it's a little more tricky. So just looking for advice there.
Well, The number one thing, and for some reason it's never as appealing to other people as it is to me, but I would definitely not explore how to make nursing care better by, you know, measuring mortality after you implement an A/B test. You know, it seems to me pretty high stakes if you try and prototype with that population. So let's not assume that you're telling people where to put the thermometer, but you're just trying to, okay, like a fitness app could just say, hey, step on a scale. I heard you say that your nurse does that. So suppose it's simply saying, hey, step on a scale. Okay, that's a lot. That's a lot of interaction. Now, what you were asking is not whether it's juicy, but how to deal with the people that it annoys. Because there is a subset, and my argument is that if you try hard enough, you can fool most of the people most of the time into not believing it, but feeling it. That's why we're talking about feelings. You don't have to believe in the Lord of the Rings to be influenced by it. And these environments that we're now beginning to explore with, again, really boring things like, you know, tax forms and mail campaigns, but we're still probing it to try and find out how to make that stuff like endurable. And a lot of that could be self-care. But if you screw up, all I can say is, I'll quote George Burns. He said, authenticity is everything in Hollywood. And as soon as you learn how to fake that, you've got it made. And so that's still true. Is that the last question? Oh, one more. Okay, great.
Hello, I have a question about how you think about localizing chatbots to different international cultures or communities, and also I think of an example of Alexa, for example, not understanding people's accents.
Yeah.
How do you get rid of bias?
That's a cool one. You've seen them interact with like a Scottish person.
Yeah,
like,
and they're like, I don't understand exactly. Does that matter?
Sure. It totally does. It's funny right now. It'll be really substantially more important when we're all trying to learn how to like AR North Korean, and we're like faking that we know the syllables and the consonants, because it'll be a make or break thing. But right now, I don't think it is. Right? Like there could be a time where we really do have to take it to heart, like do something dangerous with it. But I don't see that.
Just as a follow-up, I mean, a lot of the chatbot stuff we're seeing is text.
Right.
So, you know, it's still a language issue, and we're finding that, you know, even the examples we give, like, can I cash a check? Can you check on my cash? You know, I forgot the third example. But, you know, getting that in other languages, you know, requires a lot of effort. But my question, sorry to digress. When you showed the type of relationships, I'm thinking towards the future here.
Okay.
You know, when I think of chatbots and interacting with you, if I start to know you,
mm-hmm.
you know, maybe I have enough information, maybe with machine learning or other mechanisms, to start figuring out how I should better interact with you. And so maybe some of this type of persona definition
mm-hmm.
could be used to describe a way that I should interact with this kind of person, just as you would if you took Myers-Briggs.
Yes.
You know, and you said, well, you know, you're empathetic, so I'm going to talk to you in an empathetic way.
Right.
So, you know, I don't know if I've ever seen any of that yet.
There's a thing called the the Emotion Annotation and Response Language. And I'll include a link to it I'll post these slides. But Earl is basically what you would articulate as a way of implementing, say, these 8 buckets of appraisal. Imagine that they were written in JavaScript and it just said state, appraisal, ching, 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 ching. And they literally took the time to open source code a lot of these things as objects that you could make calls to, E-A-R-L. Here, I'll just bring it up. I mean, like, I think my internet will work, so E-A-R-L, and we'll do emotion, annotation, boom, Well, there you go. That's what you search for. Sorry. But next question. Okay.
Best practices in the context of users that are pressed on time.
Okay.
And because a lot of the things that that you were suggesting about politeness and flattery and reflecting back
mm-hmm.
adds to the amount of time that a user spends with that bot. And
yep.
So the particular context that I deal with at work is we work on a tutoring product. Students are stressed. It's 2 a.m. We are trying to match them with
tutors.
Yeah,
okay.
Online, 24/7.
Cool.
And thinking about should we use a bot to help them match with a tutor and get all the information that a tutor needs in order to figure out whether they can help or not.
Why wouldn't you? I mean, isn't that your business? Like, I mean, you're saying that you encounter some kind of quandary when you're trying to address this space with a bot.
Well, I think it's a question of, I think we're encountering the question of when is a good time to surface that bot? And what particular purpose should that bot serve? Should it be up front when we're collecting all of the information that the student needs and
yes.
we found that no, the student didn't want
that? Oh, no.
Or maybe when the student encounters a failure in that they can't get connected to the tutor, that can really help them.
It's a judgment call. You guys are gonna have to decide how much of a gnat you're gonna be. Like at one spectrum extreme, you just basically have the economics of spam. You're just assaulting everybody and they all tune you out and it cancels into something in the very low hundredth of a percentage range. Then on the other side is, you know, connected to Tim Ferriss's former assistant and he's reading everything and he's replying by hand. He's artisanally crafting little responses to each and every kid asking for a tutor. That's the other pole, okay? That's like amazing. And the question is, like, what if you are so close to the South Pole that you just suck all the time and that you should just keep your pie hole shut because you're just annoying people? Well, I would say absolutely stop talking about what you're talking about. But that doesn't mean that you don't get to talk about anything. They might be interested in the MBA, and they might be interested in astrology, and they might be interested in 1,000 things that have absolutely no information content, like puppy GIFs. Okay, there's a range of things, and it's basically like formulating pickup lines. You're hoping to get lucky. You know, you have to kind of craft it so that the relationship endures. And you know, the reason I reference Slack is that, like, clearly they have all these relationship grooming skills that are, you know, amazing, just instructive. And a lot of them are infinitely hard. You know, I mean, it's like, if you can't imitate Stewart, imitate Shakespeare. It's not that they're equivalent, but like, it just identifies how good it could be. And you should just keep trying. Like, for your particular case, I would say that you should use your own little channel to change their mindset. Because Carol Dweck spoke here 10 years ago. She has a book that basically demonstrates how trivial you can reframe something and sustain a real outcome difference. And the mindset, boiled down, is simply, look, you're going to be evaluated on this, and we're going to know how good you are after you do this. That is a really bad message. You know, perform, and I'm going to watch. If you tell people that, you know, I'm going to judge you based on how well you do on this test. Now do it. That leads to a particular kind of risk-averse perfectionism where you absolutely hate learning anything new because it's going to connect you to your ignorance, and you'll read that completely wrong. And the way you want people to read it is by saying, look, you're doing it. You're going to just keep coming back. You're going to get better and better. Don't worry where you are. It's progress, not perfection. And if you say that to tutors, like, how many people will listen? 1%. But if you have to say something nice. That's the general point, that there are nice things to say, and that will be the last nice thing I say tonight. There are really nice ways to fake it. And, you know, inside this room and outside this room, I would have to say, it's no more fake than plenty of the relationships I had with people in college where I was entirely projecting what I thought they were. And I had a great relationship with them, and it had nothing to do with them. So that's what we can still do on computers, is have relationships with people we don't know at all, because we really don't. And yet it should still feel better than it does. So that's it.
Let's all thank Paul, but he's not going to go away yet, because
no,
I
sir.
Have a question. Okay, you can give him the other mic.
What's your question?
My question is, I want to hear the top 10.
Top 10, oh, okay.
So, wait a minute, let me frame this.
Sure, sure.
Okay, so Paul has now been the host and the programmer for roughly 100.
Since December 2002, Ted Rheingold, or Howard Rheingold, was my first guy.
Howie. So, you know, roughly 100 speakers at BayCHI. So give us a top 10. Of statements from the speakers rather
yes,
than
no, of course,
who
no,
the speakers
no,
were.
No recollections,
right.
just the facts, ma'am.
Yes, yes.
And let me say at the outset, usually people go, look, if I forgot anybody, and it's me saying it, then fuck them. Because I mean, there was tons of interesting people who said tons of interesting things. Number one, well, I will remember Howard Rheingold. I obviously didn't even remember his first name. He was my first, it's never that good. And he had like amazing pants, and he paints little patterns on his shoes that just blow your mind.
How many people know who Howard Rheingold is? So not that many.
Okay, well, it doesn't really matter, but it was good for me. Then, certainly the most quoted person is the guy who did the Palm operating system, Rob Haitani. Because he just said like a couple of cones that were like so useful that you could milk them. So one was that I charged, a substantial amount of my living was made off of the mantra, provide but hide. You know, and like, if you want to know what that means, you have to pay me thousands. But it's very, very potent as a solution. So Rob Haitani.
Okay.
Then Alan Collins was a friend of mine. He was my mentor. He just published his book on re-envisioning education. He's great. I'm going to list a bunch of friends. I remember Alan Cooper and my very good friend, Philip Greenspun, agreed to speak. And it must have been 10 years ago when we still tried to honor this tradition of having two speakers, which made it a lot harder. And like, you could always get one, and you were still running around getting a second. Philip and Alan Cooper spoke. So that was a great night, except that Alan Cooper spoke for 2 hours, and he used up all the time. And when Philip finally got up at like 9:40, he said, look, for all the bladder challenged, you win, go. And you know, it was an interesting evening, but certainly fun for me. Then other people, I'm not going to go on about this. I just enjoyed it. Carol Dweck spoke, and she did, Mindset. It's a really great, powerful little flip, you know. Not perfection, progress. You can literally push yourself to continually try and hold to the progress side. And little bits help. It's psychologically correct. It fits. So I loved her. And Kelly McGonigal spoke a lot about really cool things about compassion. I ended up taking a whole year of courses with her because she does mindfulness and meditation and nervous system and stress. That was a blast. Tons of other people, tons of good, warm, salt of the earth connections. There is absolutely nothing about BayCHI that is motivated by money. There is not a bone in this organization's body that is in any way mercantile. People just do what they like, and it's a lot of fun for me. So thank you.
We can stay inside here for another half an hour, 40 minutes.